So we're inside now, 400 wines to try. What you might be aware of is we have some iconic regions in New South Wales, such as the Hunter Valley. We also have some fantastic up-and-coming regions. So we have Mudgee, we have Orange, we have the Southern Highlands, we have Tumbarumba, New England, Shoalhaven, producing some fantastic wines. Of course, we always talk about Hunter Valley Sauvignon, but let's go and try some other stuff, some new varieties you might not be aware of. James, how are you?
Very well, mate. How are you?
Good, mate. Good,
excellent.
Mate.
Welcome to City Cellar Door.
No, thank you very much.
So as you can see, we're surrounded by about 100 of the state's best wineries from the 14 wine regions. Everyone's showing their very best wares and best wines that they've got. Great day out. We've got a wonderful crowd here. It's the second day of the Sydney Cellar Door. We were here all day yesterday and another sellout crowd. So it's just wonderful. Great day out for the whole family.
And this is just the beginning, isn't it? It's not, this actually goes for a whole
month,
doesn't it?
That's right. This is the sort of the cornerstone event for the whole month's worth of activity throughout March.
Great.
We've got Dine with New South Wales Wines on at over 60 restaurants around the city. And we've got the Tour of the Wine Regions dinners. They're very specific dinners with a number of winemakers attending, going through the wines on a specifically matched degustation menu at about four of the best restaurants in town.
How good's that? So where can people actually find that, where to dine and drink New South Wales wines?
If you go to our website, which is www.newsouthwaleswinefestival.com.au, all the details are listed there, and with instructions to purchase tickets, so on and so forth.
Oh yeah, he's good, isn't he? Knows what he's talking about. Fantastic. So what's happening with New South Wales wines as a whole? What should we be looking out for?
Well, the strength of New South Wales wines is the diversity of regionality that we have. 14 wine regions stretch over a huge area and cover all sorts of cool climate, high altitude, Mediterranean, coastal influence, continental influence. So really, in one state, you've got a whole nation's worth of regional expression. Unlike some of the other states in this country, where the regions are very much clumped together, you get real expression and differentiation between all the regions. That's the strength of New South Wales wine, is this variety, but at the same time, the quality behind it as well. So there's something for everyone, really.
We're here with Peter Logan from Logan Wines from Orange. We've got some beautiful background music going, we've got some food in front of us, and when we talk about wine, I believe wine is about all those elements. You know, it's about the food, it's about the music, it's about the people. Peter is owner of Logan Wines and has some fantastic wines coming out of the Orange area. So tell me a little bit about rosé and what's happening, because we're seeing a lot more rosé in the marketplace, and you know, what's happening for you there?
Well, yeah, we're finding it great. It's funny, it's like Riesling. Everyone keeps talking about the rosé revolution sort of thing, like
sure.
The big rosé is coming back, and it's coming back, and it is. But it's coming back slower than I actually anticipated. But yesterday was a breakthrough day here at Sydney Cellar Door. I think 80, well not 80, that's an exaggeration, but 60% of the people who came up to our stand were asking for rosé,
right.
Which was fantastic. You know, it's perfect on a hot day. It goes with so much different types of food, and good dry rosés, pale in colour, are perfect for that sort of thing.
I think if you walked into a bottle shop maybe 6 to 7 years ago, you'd have had a choice of three or four rosés. One of which would have been Matus. No,
yep.
That's not really a wine.
Yeah.
And the other three would have been sickly sweet.
Yeah.
What we're seeing now in Australia is drier, more food-friendly wines.
Yeah, so. I mean, largely very influenced by the ones from Provence in the south of France, and also the Spanish ones. And those guys have been making great food-friendly rosés for, God, forever. And it's sort of got lost in the mix a bit, and people were not making that style, but finally we've discovered that style in Australia, and that's what is predominantly being made, and it just suits our climate and our food perfectly.
For sure, absolutely. It's such a versatile type of wine.
Yeah.
Doesn't necessarily need food, but match it with a picnic, some prosciutto, sitting under a big tree, olives, perfect, absolutely beautiful. So without further ado, let's try your rosé.
Yeah, no worries. Lovely, pretty little label too. Rosé has to taste good, but it's one of the few wines that has to look good too.
Yeah.
So I make this from Shiraz, Cab Franc and Pinot Noir.
So rosé can be actually made from any red grape variety, and the colour comes from the skins. So tell us about how you get the colour into the rosé.
Well, with this, a lot of the red colours are coming from the Shiraz, which I sort of pick it at the time I normally would pick Shiraz to make Shiraz and bleed a bit of juice off after about 8 hours sitting on the skins to get a bit of colour. But the Pinot Noir, you'll notice it's got sort of a little orange tinge to it as well. And that's because the Pinot Noir I pick really early and then I totally oxidize all the juice so that it turns orange rather than red.
Right.
The reason I do that is partly for the color, but also for the characters in the flavors. It loses its fruit characters and develops a whole lot of spicy characters,
right,
which is great for pairing back because the Shiraz component is really fruity.
Right.
And I don't want it to end up tasting like lolly water. So the Pinot that is there to pull back on the fruitiness and to give like a spiciness to it.
Yeah.
And then the Cabernet Franc is floral and textured.
Yeah, okay. So let's have a spin around and let's see what you think.
I hope that's a good guess.
That's a good guess. That works. Yeah, that's lovely. So you've got all those kind of fruity characters and they kind of give way to kind of a lighter style, acidity coming through, minerality coming through, mouth watering. Give me a blanket, give me a big tree, give me a beautiful
That's how it's
person.
Designed, yeah.
So, yeah. Okay, fantastic. Look, thank you very much. Gorgeous wine.
No worries.
Thanks for your
thank
time.
You. Cheers.
Thanks. When we talk about Hunter Valley, just north of Sydney, one winery normally just springs to mind, and that's Tyrrells. We're going to talk to Scott today about Tyrrells Semillon. I'm going to have a look at a couple of the wines, the Lost Block and the Vat One. Now, the Vat One is Australia's most awarded white wine, so it's picked up more trophies and gold medals than any other white wine. Let's say hello to Scott. Let's look at the wines.
Welcome.
Hey, Scott, how you going, mate?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, good to see you.
Very good. So we're looking at Semillon. The Hunter Valley's been making wine or growing grapes for over 180 odd years, so we've had a chance to experiment. So apart from Semillon, we're also renowned for Chardonnay and Shiraz, but it's our point of difference. That's why people tend on to bang on a lot more about Semillon. Yeah. So it's a lean, high-acid style of wine. I mean, this is Vat 1. We're looking at alcohols around 10%.
Yeah.
They're not big, broad styles of wine. They're very elegant. They're very more European, stylistically.
Yeah.
So we've got a young one here, which is a lot more aromatic. This is a Lost Block.
And let's very quickly talk about the labelling there, because what you've got on there, it are some descriptors that make it very easy for the person who's walking into the bottle shop, looking through that glass door into the fridge and confronted by a sea of wines. You've got four words on there which kind of just sum up this wine. So light, refreshing, unoaked, Australian. And we've talked about the importance of drinking Australian wines already. Sorry, Scott.
No, fine.
Can we talk a little bit about, we can talk about terroir a little bit when we talk about Hunter Semillon in particular, because it has this unique character of over time, a Hunter Valley Semillon will develop into beautiful kind of buttery,
honey,
toasty
characters.
Yeah.
So I liken it to hemp or the fiber, you know, like brown string. So best descriptive term is one that communicates. But they start off people on the sort of citrus fruit end of the spectrum, you know, so lime, lemon, grapefruit. And as they age, those primary fruit characters fall away and they're replaced by these secondary bottle age characters. And that gives the wine greater weight, more complexity. But they age extremely gracefully. This guy here is 7 years old. And conceivably, wines like this, you're looking 10, 15, 20 years. The reality is, now we've moved over to screw cap, we really don't know how long they're going to age. So, Semillon is, it's like the sashimi of the wine world. It's all about the quality of the fruit. It's more of an exercise in a winemaker's restraint. There's no weird and wonderful yeast strains, there's no oak maturation, no malolactic fermentation. So it's very simply made, you know. And I suppose it's more a tribute to the viticulturalist than the winemaker. So it is a true expression of terroir. There is no tinkering.
They always say that the great wines are made in the vineyard, don't they?
Yeah.
So before it actually hits the winery. Okay, we're here with Will Haddersley from Belgravia Wines. Again, we're back in Orange. We've got some beautiful music going on. We've got a glass of Chardonnay here. Will, can you tell us a bit about Chardonnay and what's happening with Chardonnay at the moment?
Well, Chardonnay is probably my favourite white variety and possibly, I think, probably my favourite wine in general. Chardonnay, we're finding from Orange, the sales have actually picked up a lot. We probably tended to have, we're selling a lot of Pinot Gris, but the Chardonnay is really, seems that people are coming back to it, and I think they're liking those cool climate ones. So, the ones with sort of lots of natural acid and good flavours, not too heavy.
Sure. So Chardonnay was one of the things that put us on the map in Australia overseas. Big, rich, oaky, full of colour and flavour. Died in the water, got killed in the water when Sauvignon Blanc came along, all those, you know, different wine varieties. Chardonnay's coming back. Cool climate Chardonnay is really where it's at the moment. Chardonnay can offer you probably more complexity in any white wine than any other grape variety. So, yeah, let's have a taste and see what we think. So on the nose, very light and delicate, melons, grapefruit. Has it seen any oak at all? Have you put some oak in there? A little bit?
Yeah, it has. It's probably about, oh, it's all, it's about half, 50% new oak, and then, but all aged in, all aged in oak and straight into the, basically fermenting in there as well, so.
Yeah, so the oak has given it a lovely texture, a lovely kind of softness almost. And you've had a bit of lees stirring on that?
Yeah, all wild yeast, hand plunging, yeah.
Yeah, so basically it's been sitting on dead yeast, which really softens the wine out, makes a lovely textural wine. This is gorgeous. This is really, how much would this retail for?
$30.
$30, absolute bargain. Going out and spending $30 on wine, Belgravia Chardonnay, fantastic. Hope you've enjoyed today. We've visited some great wineries. We've just shown you there's a great diversity of wines in New South Wales, from your really light Semillons going right through to your big Zinfandels. Fantastic range. A lot of these regions are very, very close to Sydney, so it's not hard to get to. As you can see, the atmosphere is great here today. Lots of people. We've had sun, we've had a little bit of rain, but it hasn't dampened anything. We've got a band going on. It's a great day out. In fact, it's 2 days out, so come and join us next year. Ben Hughes for Spit Bucket. I'm going for a refill.